pressure. Can you give it? Can you take it? Can you feel it? Playoff baseball.
Tonight from Wrigley Field in Chicago, with the best of five series even at a game apiece, it's the Braves and Cubs in Game 3 of the Division Series. For Dusty Baker and the Central Division champion Cubs, postseason hopes rest with their powerful young arms. In Game 1, Kerry Wood shut down Atlanta's powerful sluggers, setting the stage for a critical Game 2 for the Braves. Facing the flamethrower, Carlos Zambrano, the Braves sluggers turned into singles hitters to rally. And that set the stage for an unlikely hero, Mark DeRosa. That one is hit well into the left center. Going back, Moises Alou is still going back. He can't get it! 5-3 Atlanta! The series reduced to a best of three, the scene shifts to Wrigley Field and a classic pitching matchup. The great veteran, Greg Maddux, a four-time Cy Young winner, up against the great young star, the Cubs' Mark Pryor. Maddux, at age 37, in what could be his final chance with the Braves against the 23-year-old sensation. It's the critical Game 3 from the friendly confines.
Pressure. Can you feel it? Playoff baseball.
The rain has gone away, and right now they are ready. Moments ago, they were virtually at a fever pitch at Wrigley Field as Wayne Mesmer sang the national anthem, and that was followed by a very lusty rendition of Let's Go Cubs. They are ready for baseball here at Wrigley Field. The big crowd has been ready for quite a while. We've had a rain delay, but now the field is in as good a shape as it could be. They put that water-absorbent sand-like material around the infield dirt, and Mark Pryor has gone back to the bullpen taking his warm-ups. He warmed up for 10 or 15 minutes before the rain brought the proceedings to a halt, and Greg Maddux is back in the visiting bullpen getting his warm-ups in once again. I'm John Miller with Joe Morgan, and here we go. The electricity is pulsing through Wrigley Field. They've got two ball clubs, one the upstart and one the proud Atlanta Braves. I mean, they're always here. This is a little bit of a new thing for these Chicago Cubs and for Mark Pryor. And not for Greg Maddux, the veteran master. He's been here so many times before, Joe.
Well, all the talk has been about Mark Pryor. But guess what? Greg Maddux can't take second billing to anyone. He's a future first ballot Hall of Famer. He's been here before. Don't take him for granted. This should be a great ball game. The Cubs, like you say, are upstart. The Braves have all been here before, too. This is going to be a great series.
All right, so Pryor, who is so sensational down the stretch, almost an automatic win, but he has never faced this scenario before. We'll see Pryor moments away from heading to the mound. He'll be up against that great Braves lineup, including Gary Sheffield. Stay tuned.
Program in the first, $4.
Summer wind.
Snacks in the fourth, $25.
From across the sea.
A soda at the end of the seventh, $3.
It lingered there.
Friday night, no TV, DVDs, or video games.
And walk with
priceless.
Me.
There are some things money can't buy. For everything else, there's MasterCard. Devoted fan of Major League Baseball.
One thing that can break up any party? A broken chip.
Get Tostitos Gold. The Tostitos that are made extra thick. Perfect for hearty dips. Tastes so good, you never know who'll show up.
So, guy goes into a bar.
Tostitos Gold. The perfect chip for hearty dips.
Sorry, I was driving too fast.
No, my fault. You must be gelling like Magellan.
Dr. Scholl's massaging gel insoles are so soft, they make any shoe feel outrageously comfortable. Are you gelling? Dr. Scholl's.
Dave.
Brian. Are these your consultants?
They're providing an ongoing assessment.
We're on a standardized Dell Linux solution. PowerEdge servers, Intel Xeon processors.
What about assessment? Validation? Deployment?
Dell services are proven and scalable end-to-end. They're customer-centric.
We're more, contractually inseparable.
Manage your enterprise for less with the flexibility of Dell products and services. Call or go online today.
I break for yard sales.
I break for animals.
I break for
Donuts.
Chocolate.
My grandkids.
Boys.
I break for little old ladies.
Bingo.
Leprechauns.
UFOs.
I break for free oil changes.
Visit your local Midas mechanic now and get a free oil change with any Midas brake job, including installation of our lifetime guaranteed brake pads or shoes. That's free oil and filter with any new brakes.
I break for no apparent reason.
L.A.'s best cops, solving its worst cases. The season premiere brings a crime so wicked.
What kind of filthy animal would do this?
Even these cops will lose it.
The most tortured and burning death!
L.A. Dragnet premieres Saturday, 10, 9 central on ABC. Presentation of the 2003 MLB Division Series. Brought to you by 1-800-COLLECT, Save a Buck or Two, and Washington Mutual Home Loans. We write our own approval rules so you can get into the house without the hassles. An equal housing lender.
The umpires have met at home plate and have been the recipients of the lineup cards from the two teams. Game 3 of the National League Division Series, the Braves and Cubs, moments away from getting started. Mark Pryor still taking his warm-ups in the home bullpen along the left field line. And he will, I'm sure, be given as much time as he needs to get ready here. Remember, he warmed up for 10 or 15 minutes before and then had the whole thing brought to a halt because of the rain. John Miller, Joe Morgan up in the booth, and Gary Miller is also here with us. Let's go to Gary.
John, as you know, it rained here all day and then let up until right before game time. So the field was already soaked. Now it's really kind of a quagmire, although the outfield, Chipper Jones and Gary Sheffield, who were out here before, didn't seem too concerned about it. One thing to watch for is foul balls along the dugout. There are puddles here gathered, even though they've sanded in the infield and on the mound. Here could be a little tricky. And you're not talking about the fleetest of outfielders to begin with, except for Andrew Jones and Lofton. So that could be a major factor. It's going to slow the ball down and slow down outfielders who aren't the greatest defensively to begin with, besides the center fielders.
All right, so, this is not like all the new ballparks where they have that subterranean water drainage system. I mean, this is Wrigley Field that opened for baseball in 1914. And when it rains, this field will hold some water. Game one, the Cubs, of course, back of Kerry Wood, won in Atlanta, 4-2. Wood was sensational that night. And in game two, which we were able to bring you on ESPN on Wednesday night, the Braves were victorious, 5-3. Mark DeRosa with a dramatic two-run double in the last of the eighth. And Mark Pryor now, the 23-year-old, has finished his warm-ups, and he's heading down into the Chicago dugout on the third base side. Damian Miller, who caught that great tandem in Arizona when the Diamondbacks won the World Series a couple of years ago, Curt Schilling and Randy Johnson, and he's going to be handling Mark Pryor tonight here in Chicago. He's also had a lot of success against Greg Maddux. Moises Alou, who's hit well in this series, and Alou and Sosa have been on base all the time, but they've not been getting much production from the guys behind those guys. The bottom of the order has not been giving the Cubs any production at all. And the Cubs have not hit any homers yet in this series. Kenny Lofton's been on base a lot. Two hits and two walks. He's had a steal. He's had a .400 on base percentage so far.
Well, I think if Kenny Lofton can get on base in this ballgame, he can take advantage of Greg Maddux, who does not hold runners well, who allows you to steal bases. And I think Dusty Baker's seen enough of Greg Maddux to know that you can't let him just get comfortable out there on the mound. You have to make things happen. You have to force the action. You got to steal a few bases. You got to hit and run because he's always around the plate. So I think you can do a few things to disrupt Maddux, because once he gets in a groove, you're in trouble.
And Greg Maddux, I mean, what a career it's been. And every year he pitches in big games. I mean, the Braves are always in these games every year.
Well, but the one thing, if you look at his record's not that good in postseason play. I mean, he has made a lot of starts in postseason play, and is 11-13. So, you know, as he has been in the regular season, he has not carried over to the postseason.
Sammy Sosa leads the Cubs onto the field, sprinting out to salute the fans in the bleachers. So the Cubs have taken the field, and we're going to take a look now at the Atlanta Braves batting order. Brought to you by Bristol-Myers Squibb. And for Atlanta, Rafael Furcal at shortstop. Marcus Giles back in the lineup at second base. He had to sit out the ballgame, although he came in as a pinch hitter, had a huge hit in the Wednesday ballgame. Gary Sheffield in right field. Chipper Jones in left, hitting cleanup. Javi Lopez, the catcher, in the fifth spot again, as he Wednesday. Andrew Jones in center. Robert Fick at first, hitting seventh. Vinny Castilla at third base. Greg Maddux, the pitcher, batting ninth against 23-year-old Sensen. Mark Pryor, not that far removed from college, and already he has emerged as the ace of this Cubs staff, helping propel them into the postseason. Mark Pryor throws a variety of pitches, and he told us about his pitches.
Basic four-seam fastball, and then my curve, slider, slurve, breaking ball pitch is just down the horseshoe, a little bit over the horseshoe, and just bring it down, and then occasionally I throw my changeup, which is just a little bit off the circle change. I just bring it up and just release it out.
Well, his fastball is the one that explodes on the hitter, but he also throws, he calls it a breaking ball because sometimes it's a hard pitch like a slider, other times it's more like a curve ball, a little slower. So that's why he calls it curve, slurve, whatever. And then he has the changeup. So anytime that he can stay around the plate, he doesn't have to throw all strikes because you do not have enough time to wait and decide whether it's a strike or not. If he stays around the plate, he's going to be very difficult to handle.
So here is Pryor, ready to face Furcal, and game three is about to begin at Wrigley Field. This ballpark did open in 1914, and yet in all those years, there have been only 21 postseason games played at Wrigley Field. The last one was 5 years ago. The Braves were here, and the pitcher for the Braves that night was Greg Maddux, and he beat the Cubs to give the Braves a sweep of that series. And a strike. So Pryor's first pitch, a 94-mile-an-hour fastball on the outside, and we are underway. Furcal, 2-for-8 so far in this series. Inside. A ball and a strike now. Furcal, the igniter for the Braves. It's a real cool night, 54 degrees, but a little bit of a breeze blowing in from left field. And that is a fastball. Strike two call.
Well, like the guy that he admires, he's thrown a fastball over the outside corner and now a fastball over the inside corner. So he is not just trying to overpower you by throwing the ball down the middle of the plate.
And the breaking ball is too low. 2-2. Broken bat. And one away. Gregelotic throwing out Furcal.
Now let's take a look at the defense behind Pryor. Miller has caught some of the hardest throwing pitchers in the game. Randy Johnson and Curt Schilling. Simons at first base. Gregelotic, good defensive, not a great one, but good. Martinez very steady at shortstop. And Ramirez at third has been the weak link, but he's playing much better now.
And a strike in the inside to Marcus Giles. Giles 2-for-3 in this series. He hit the homer against Kerry Wood that had the Braves leading for a while in that game. And then he got a big pinch hit single to put the Braves ahead in game two on Wednesday. He injured himself, of course, taking a tumble at first base in game one. Had a deep bruise on his thigh. But he pronounced himself fit and ready to play for this game tonight. A ball and a strike. And that curve snaps in there. Strike two right at the knees.
John, our graphic had Martinez at shortstop, but that's Gonzalez at shortstop.
Alex Gonzalez.
Not Martinez.
Very high with the fastball. Gary Sheffield on deck. Two balls, two strikes to Giles, who had a sensational season, a breakthrough season for the Braves. And he struck him out. Hard stuff on the outside.
That's the pitch that I've seen a lot of in the highlights. That fastball toward the outside corner, and it just explodes past the hitter. It may only be 96 miles an hour, but there's an explosion there. See, that ball just jumps past Giles.
And that last one, of course, at full speed. You have to make, as you said, Joe, a quick decision whether you're swinging or not.
Yeah, that's why he doesn't have to throw all strikes, but he has to be around the plate, and they will help him out.
Now Sheffield, power versus power here. And he starts him with the curve, but misses just off the outside. Sheffield has had one hit and eight at-bats, although his manager, Bobby Cox, quick to point out that Sheffield has clobbered three balls real hard without getting a hit. And he says he's very satisfied with Sheffield's swing right now. Inside, and it is 2-0. Well, there's certainly no question about Sheffield's ability to catch up to this guy's fastball or anybody's fastball.
Correct. He can handle anyone's fastball.
2-0. And 3-0.
And I think they're aware of that. I mean, you see them trying to stay tight on him with the fastball. They do not want to get it out over the plate where he can extend on it. But he may be swinging 3-0 anyway. We'll see how aggressive Bobby Cox wants to be tonight.
And it's ball four. So Sheffield gets the two-out walk, and now Chipper Jones will come up. Also one hit, eight at-bats. Bobby Cox in his 18th season as a big league manager. He hadn't managed that year that many years for just the Braves, but he's had a great run of success for the Braves, 12 consecutive division championships. So they're a perennial fixture in the postseason. But as John Smoltz was saying the other day, if they lose this series, Smoltz thinks there'll be a lot of changes with the Braves in terms of personnel. And there's ball one to Chipper Jones. He's had one hit and eight at-bats in the series. And back to the bag is Sheffield. Sheffield did a lot of running during the season, especially early. He had 18 steals, caught only five. But then he injured his thumb on one of those steals. And Bobby Cox suggested maybe he can cut back on that running game a little bit. And that breaking ball misses. 2-0. And all of a sudden, Pryor has lost the strike zone.
Well, he's lost the strike zone because he's facing Gary Sheffield and Chipper Jones. And you know you have to make quality pitches. You can't just try to get ahead of these guys. You've got to try to use the outside corner or go to their weaknesses.
And for the seventh straight pitch, he is out of the strike zone. But, I mean, all of the talk about Pryor and how great he's been and how the Cubs have been winning so often when he pitches and the great stuff that he has versus Maddox. Maddox has been here many times. This is Pryor's first experience on this big stage. Sheffield swinging away on 3-0, but he fouls one. Sheffield. Chipper Jones was Sheffield at first. Chipper Jones swinging away on 3-0 and fouling it off into the crowd.
And I think Bobby Cox wants these guys to be aggressive. I thought he would let Sheffield swing 3-0, but the pitch was up and out of the zone, so he lets Chipper Jones swing 3-0. Remember, this is a small ballpark compared to what the Atlanta Braves play in during the season. Without the wind being dominant here tonight, they're going to be free swinging, trying to hammer him when they get ahead of it.
And it's another walk. And so a very rare scenario for Pryor, walking two in a row. Pryor walked 50 during the season in 211 and a third innings. So, I mean, he averaged about two walks for every nine innings pitched. And now he's walked two consecutive hitters. So here is Javi Lopez, and he's been getting his hits so far in the postseason. Four hits, eight at bats, although no long balls for Javi. And he hit 43 of them during the season. Sheffield now at second. Chipper Jones now at first. And Pryor trying to find that strike zone again. And he finds it there, right at the outside edge with a fastball.
The one thing you notice from Pryor, he has not thrown a pitch in the middle of the plate, even to the first two hitters who were not, you know, considered real long ball threats, although they do have some power. And with Sheffield and Chipper Jones, he was always trying to hit the edge.
Almost a wild pitch, a great save by Damian Miller on a real sharp breaking ball. One ball, one strike.
Now Miller does a good job. I mean, he's ready for it. He couldn't get out there, but he at least got the glove out there. Couldn't get his entire body over there, but he got the job done.
But right now, Mark Pryor's not quite right. Two men on, two men out. He's walked two in a row. Andruw Jones would be next. And he was supposed to go inside with that fastball. That's down the right field line and twisting back and out of play right near the foul pole. There's just a little bit of wind blowing in from left and across toward right.
Well, you can see the flags blowing this way toward right field, toward the right field line.
So now a one ball, two strike count. And the customers here at Wrigley try to come to the aid of their young right-hander, Mark Pryor. Everybody on their feet. Sheffield at second. Chipper Jones at first, ready to go on anything. Two down. Struck him out! So Pryor recovers after a momentary lapse. A 23-pitch first inning. Now the Cubs are coming up.
I think when I was younger, I just wanted to come up with a style of my own. The only thing I come with is the leg kick. It becomes a part of you. I live for this.
Watch the Division Series on ESPN. Don't miss it.
No matter where life takes you, Verizon Wireless lets you stay in touch anytime. Hurry and get unlimited, that's right, unlimited night and weekend minutes to use coast to coast when on the America's Choice Network. Act now and you can save big on a great selection of cool Motorola phones. So you can keep up with friends, family, and everyone in between. Verizon Wireless, we never stop working for you.
Can you hear me now? Good.
Law and order.
You're in contempt, Mr. McCoy.
After 13 seasons and 300 episodes, the original still remains the best. Law and order. See it every weeknight, starting at 6. Only on
TNT.
TNT.
Wrigley Field in Chicago. It's game three of the National League Division Series, the Braves and the Cubs. Braves have gone down, stranding two runners. Now the Cubs are coming up against Greg Maddux. And here's the Bristol-Myers squib. Cubs batting order turned in by manager Dusty Baker. Kenny Lofton in center. Mark Rudzielanek at second. Sammy Sosa in right. He hadn't hit any home runs in this series, but he'd been on base a lot. So has Moises Alou, the left fielder. Randall Simon at first base. Aramis Ramirez, third base. Alex Gonzalez back in the game at short. Damian Miller, the catcher. And Mark Pryor, the pitcher, hitting ninth against the 37-year-old master, Greg Maddux. 289 career wins, including 16 this year, marking the 16th consecutive year that he's won 15 or more, which is an all-time big league record. Now that ERA, though, Joe, that's the highest he's ever had since going to Atlanta.
Well, when you face Greg Maddux, you know he's going to work off of the fastball. His fastball is what he uses to hit the corners. He makes it sink. He makes it cut. That's basically what he does, and then he'll throw a lot of changeups off the fastball, but everything comes off the fastball. He does have a curveball, but he doesn't throw it a lot.
So here's Lofton. Greg Maddux made his major league debut as a Chicago Cub in 1986. He was only 20 years old at the time. Made his first start in September of that year. And he misses low for a ball.
I think Kenny Lofton is going to be the key for the Cubs tonight. If he can get on base, he can disrupt Maddux a little bit by stealing bases and running.
That's a strike. One ball, one strike to Lofton. Lofton, two hits, eight at-bats, plus two walks in this series. So he's been on base four times out of 10. Third baseman Castillo, very shallow. You see him there on the left side. And that runs in a little bit off the plate. 2-1 to Lofton.
Well, that's the cut fastball he'll throw. We saw the sinker on the first pitch.
That is foul right past G.
Gene Kline's the first base coach, and into the visiting bullpen area.
Well, he showed them all his pitches. That was the changeup. He's thrown the fastball, he's thrown the sinking fastball, the cut fastball, and the changeup.
Two to Lofton. And again, a foul ball. Maddox with his 16 wins this year. And he didn't often go real deep into games, but he was very reliable. He always made his starts. He made more starts than any other National League pitcher. And he got that ball up as he took something off that pitch, but got it up, and Lofton hit it foul into the seats off to the left. Just kind of swatted at him.
Well, this is a good at-bat for Lofton and for his Cub teammates to get a chance to see what Maddox is doing out there, if they didn't already know.
And another foul ball again. Took a little something off that one, and Lofton hit it foul. Maddox has made 10 appearances in division series play, 15 in league championship series. That one down the right field line. On the run, Sheffield, it's in there. Base hit. Lofton with a turn at first, but it'll hold as Sheffield has a real strong arm. So Kenny Lofton with quite a battle, and he wins the duel on the eighth pitch. He gets the hit.
Let's take a look at the Braves defense. We saw Sheffield in right field, and he has a very strong arm, and that's why Kenny Lofton respected him on that. Andrew Jones, of course, one of the best outfielders in the game. Chipper Jones in left. And the infield will make some errors, but they can get the job done. They made a great double play on Lofton the other day. And Maddox is the best fielding pitcher. He's won like 15 or 16 straight gold gloves, so 13 gold gloves. This is a very good middle-of-the-lineup defense. But they will make some mistakes, but they have a lot of range.
Hey, I caught you there being precise. I appreciate that. Now Grudzielana, he pushes the bunt up the first base side. Fick falls down. He can't handle it. Everybody's safe. And remember, we're playing on a wet field tonight. Rain fell right after they were introducing all the players on both clubs. And a pretty heavy rain fell on this field before they got the tarp over the infield.
Well, a lot of people will wonder, why do you bunt in the first inning? Well, you try to get a run for a guy like Pryor who can't shut the Braves down. You see right there, Fick slips down and no play. Everybody's safe. But I think it was a smart play by Dusty Baker to try to get the lead right away.
Now, I don't see this guy bunting.
I doubt it.
Although they would be shocked.
One thing else that you also have to be aware of is Kenny Lofton at second base, because Maddox does not check the runner that often at second base. He allows you to run if you want to.
And there's that trademark Maddox fastball that starts off the corner and then hooks back to the plate.
Well, what he wants here is a ground ball, so he's going to try to mix in some sinkers. Unless he gets ahead, then he might go for the strikeout, but he wants a ground ball.
Sammy with three hits and five at-bats in this series, plus four walks. So the Braves have been pitching around him a lot. They've kept him in the ballpark, but he's been getting his hits.
Well, the one thing that Sammy Sosa has done the last few years, he's become a much better hitter. He will use the entire ballpark. He hits right center to left center. I mean, you pitch him out there a lot, he will go the other way.
One strike to count to Sosa. Two men on, nobody out. The Cubs trying to jump ahead here. In the dirt. One ball, one strike. Sosa, three homers in 59 lifetime at bats against Maddox. So these two veterans have been going at it head to head for a long time, and Sammy only has a 220 lifetime average against Maddox. And there aren't many hitters who have hit much better than that against Maddox over the years. Sammy Sosa, 40 homers during the season. Lofton at second, Grunzelmann at first, nobody out. And Maddox bluffs a pickoff to second. Nobody was covering.
Yeah, but they are aware of Lofton, and that's important, because if you give any of your concentration to the guy at second base, that means you have less concentration on the hitter. So Lofton's doing his job, making them aware that he's there and that he might steal a base.
That graphic was interesting. Now they're going to actually make a pickoff attempt, and Giles accepting that throw a little bit late. Lofton back in. You saw that graphic. About a third of the runs that Maddox has allowed this year have come in the first inning, so this is the time to get to him. It often has taken him a while to settle in on the mound.
Well, the better pitchers are always that way. If you're going to get them, you have to get them early.
Now you see Lofton getting his lead at second. Giles is shaded toward the middle, the second baseman.
Well, they're having a lot of problems with the signs, meaning Lopez wants one pitch, Maddox wants another, and we know that over the years he has not caught Greg Maddox very often. I guess it has been 5 years before he started catching him down the stretch this year so that he would be prepared to catch him in the playoffs. They're not used to working together, and they're having a lot of problems. You see Maddox, when he stands there, he shook him off a few times, but when he stands there that long, that disrupts his rhythm. They're going to have to get on the same page, or he's going to have problems most of the evening.
Lofton with his lead from second. Giles bluffs in behind him. And Sammy at that high, tight fastball, fouling it back into the second deck. One ball, two strikes now. Moise Salou, another powerful hitter, is on deck. The last time prior to in mid-September was in the regular season, 1998. The last time he caught him in the postseason was 7 years ago in the 1996 World Series. 1-2 the count to Sosa. And Sammy strikes out. He chased the high one up out of the strike zone.
Well, Maddox is a very smart pitcher. I mean, he will get you looking down and away, down and in, and then all of a sudden he'll throw the high fastball, especially if he gets ahead of you in the count and has two strikes on you. See, this is way up out of the strike zone, and Sammy swings at it.
And he swung at a couple. He fouled off the previous one and missed this one entirely. You think Sammy looked a little over-anxious there?
Well, I mean, Greg Maddox does that to you. He doesn't overpower you. He'll give you a little here, a little there, take a little off, put a little on, and he keeps you off balance. That's what he does best.
Now Moise Salou, still two men on, one man out. That's Lofton at second. Giles bluffs in behind him, but he was only bluffing. Maddox also bluffed a throw. Lofton went back to the bag. Moise Salou, three hits, eight at-bats. Finished the season with an injury to his left thumb that he sustained on trying to make a diving catch in the outfield. But he says it's fine now. Not anything that bothers him at all. That ball is hit well into center field. Not that well. Jones took a quick step back and then just stood and waited for it, and it was a routine play.
Well, another high fastball. And Moise Salou is a good first ball fastball hitter, so he goes after it. Moise is a good first ball fastball hitter. Maddox knows that, so he's not going to groove it. Throws it up at the top of the strike zone. It looked a little higher than that to me, but Moise Salou went after it, and he couldn't do much with it.
Alou, who's had 72 lifetime at-bats against Maddox now, 17 hits. He's never hit a home run against him. So two men are gone, and here is Randall Simon.
And that's why Greg Maddox is such a good pitcher. Got in trouble the first two hitters. He faced the three and four hitters and got them out.
And that's ball one to Simon. Simon hitting in the fifth spot where Ramirez had been hitting. Simon, the lefty, up against Maddox. These are former teammates. Simon came up with the Braves originally. Simon, he's a bad ball hitter. And he will swing at almost anything you throw up there, including this one.
Well, these are registering right at the top of the zone. I think we have to adjust that zone a little bit.
Well, if Maddox could throw one a foot higher than that, I think he'd still swing at it. 1-1 the count. Well, thank you, Randall. I don't know if that was a foot high, but that was way up there. One ball and two strikes. Let's see what K-Zone says.
Well, I guess K-Zone registers that as high.
That was high. So if you're Maddox, you go back up there again?
Well, I think Greg has a game plan. I mean,
1-2 the count. Lofton is running.
And the ball gets by Lopez. And Lofton turns third, then slips and falls and has to dive safely back to the bag just ahead of the tag by Castilla. Rudziladek moved over to second.
Well, we have to see how they score that. Lofton, of course, should get a stolen base, but I don't know if Rudziladek ran after the ball got away. Rudziladek was going back, so that'll either be a wild pitch or a pass ball that allowed Rudziladek to go to second base. And sure, there you see Lofton slipping down, and quick reaction by Javi.
So it's a steal for Lofton, his second of the series. And Rudziladek moves up on the wild pitch. Good heads-up throw there by Javi Lopez, and he almost got Lofton after he fell over. 2-2 to Simon, a base hit, committed a couple of runs. Into right field. Sheffield can't get to it. Base hit. Lofton has scored, and here's Rudziladek. 2-0 Cubs. Simon gets a big one against his old team.
Chasing pitches out of the zone. This pitch is up and in, and he jams him, but he fights it off well enough to dump it in the right field for a base hit. Now watch. You see Javi Lopez set up inside. The pitch is going to be inside. Fights it off, and he gets a base hit.
Now Aramis Ramirez, another former Pirate.
Well, he definitely gets, you see, gets jammed here, but if you're strong, you can muscle the ball into the outfield, and that's what he does. And you have to give Dusty Baker credit because he flip-flopped Ramirez with Simon, and the reason he did that because he wanted to break up all those right-handers in a row.
So here's Ramirez. You know, actually, Maddox has done pretty well against the Cubs tonight. It's the Pittsburgh Pirates who are beating him. Kenny Lofton, who started the year with the Pirates, led off with a single, eventually stole a bag, and then Randall Simon, acquired more recently for the Pirates, gets the two-out clutch hit. And here's another former Pirate, Ramirez, at the plate. One ball, one strike. And the Maddox changing speeds on that one a little more softly. One ball, two strikes now. Lofton with the Cubs at 327 really ignited the offense for the top of the order, just as he did with the Giants last year after being acquired in trade. Aramis Ramirez, he had as many RBIs in about 60 games playing third base as all the other Cubs third basemen all year. And then, of course, Randall Simon. Give him a left-handed option for first base. And he fights that curveball off, bouncing it foul. Still 1-2. So Pryor, stake to a lead here, John. You were talking about it earlier as to why Rudziladek would be bunting. I mean, now Pryor has that lead.
Yeah, well, you want to try to get ahead. If you have two pitchers who you think are going to be on top of their games that particular night, try to give him something to work with.
The wide open right side just past the dive of Giles. Simon stops at second as Sheffield throws in behind him. Ramirez with just a chop on the infield, but the first baseman playing in the bag, that's a wide open right side, and he exploited it.
Well, that's the sinker that Maddox throws, and it's away, and Ramirez does a good job. He just goes the other way. He doesn't try to pull it. Giles not able to run it down. It was a, as you said, there was a big hole on the right side, and Ramirez hit it through the right side.
And the Cubs fans doing the sarcastic tomahawk chop now at Wrigley. Alex Gonzalez into the hole at short for Cowell. The Giles covering at second with a force out on Ramirez. Four base hit, including a bunt, and the Cubs have a 2-0 lead.